So Spencer, thanks again for coming here. We want to talk about the show, particularly season five. But to start things off, take us on your journey a little bit. What got you into acting and how did you get involved with Rick and Morty?
Wow, that's such a lovely question. Thank you for asking that. It's sort of a family affair, the acting business. My mother was a dancer on Broadway, and obviously my father is Kelsey Grammer, so he was a
Frasier.
theater actor and then became a television star and many more. I've always been a big fan of animation. I think part of my introduction to it was when my father was voicing Sideshow Bob. It's always been one of the things that people have brought up to me quite often as one of the coolest things he's done. And I just am a fan of animation in general. I mean, I grew up watching like Beavis and Butthead and Aeon Flux and Daria and all those shows on MTV, the sort of adult animation. So it was always something in my frame of reference. And then I got asked to do a guest voice for Robot Chicken on Adult Swim, actually. And I had a lot of fun doing that. And then I was doing Greek on ABC Family, which was the show that launched my career. And I got pregnant after the show was over. And I was like, well, since I'm going to be chubby for a while, which is only like about 9 months anyway, right? I was like, I should like get into this voiceover thing. Like, this is a cool, like, I really, first of all, really enjoyed it. And I was at an agency where they had a booth, and it just kind of, I just started auditioning for it for a few years. And Rick and Morty, I got a call back for and ended up going in for it when I was 8 months pregnant and met like Justin and Dan. And then they were like, you didn't sound so pregnant on your tape. And I was like, funny joke, guys, really funny. And then I ended up getting it. That original read that I did for that audition was very much what I think Justin was looking for. And he knew, apparently, from some of the interviews I read and talking to him too, he knew that I was the voice that he wanted to play for Summer. And then I think as we've gone along, my feminist nature and independent streak, I think definitely influenced parts of Summer as being an independent, free-thinking female character. And then we've sort of come up now for the last 10 years in a world in which there's been pressure to highlight characters like that, build more three-dimensional female characters. And it's been such great luck to have a show that's been so popular that also allows for that growth in these characters, especially with Beth's character as well, So that's kind of my journey, but I've always wanted to act. I started off as a dancer. I've always been involved in the arts, and acting seemed like something I could do for a very, very long time. And it's been a passion of mine, storytelling, and spent a lot of time honing those skills, and then just general malaise of having a well-built a level of emotion easily accessible makes it really, really something that's provided a lot of healing and lovely things in my life. Truly, it's like we call it a healing art in some ways.
A healing art. That's I'll have to tweet that or something. But no, thank you so much for sharing that, Spencer. You know, that's interesting. You talk about your background in the live action space. It seems like all of the best voice actors tend to have some sort of background doing that. They're not just voice actors, they are actors, you know. I feel like it's easy from the outside looking in to kind of separate the two, but they're interchangeable.
Sure. I mean, I think there's certain, like, I didn't know going into this how much I was gonna love voice acting. I think I actually prefer it, to actual on-camera acting. I mean, I love doing that too, but I don't get to make like weird noises the way that I do for voice acting. Like, I think I have a clip on my Instagram that's from an old thing that they did for Rick and Morty where I had to like voice what it would be like to make a fart sound, and like we don't get to do that on camera. Like, there's really no farting on camera. That's not something that can happen. Or like you don't even have to think about what sound that would be. You're just like making a face. So for me, all that action stuff is like the bread and butter, like my favorite part of doing it, because I basically act like a 5-year-old child. Like, yeah. I'm doing like battle sequences with myself and I'm like, so I did work today. Do you know what I did today? And I love that. Absolutely.
Yeah. Well, I'm glad to hear that you love it so much. And that passion definitely shines through your character, you know? I mean, Summer is a very memorable, round character, you know?
Thank you.
Yeah. Probably one of my favorites personally. But you've given us kind of a profile of who she is. For the fewer listeners we have who maybe haven't seen the show yet, shame on them. Tell us a bit about Summer. What makes her tick? How does she contribute to the Smith family dynamic?
You know, it started off where she was just, I think, pretty much Summer was just a typical female teenage character, angsty teenage character, sort of, you know, in a way based off the Grizzled family, I think, from, you know, a Family Vacation, right? Like, so I guess in some ways I always sort of thought of her as that, like, when can she get the hell out of this crazy, awful family? Like, so many things are happening for Summer, right? And that continued to like grow her character, but she ended up having a lot of agency in her own life force and particularly against Rick. So I think that it grew her character a lot because she was a good foil to him, in the way that Morty was so subservient. Like, Summer continued to be a catalyst to, you know, question Rick's choices, to push him a little bit. And then also I think now we've created a symbiotic relationship in which I'm sort of his go-to fix the problem Summer. You know, as you can see in that, I think that teased first episode, I'm definitely going off and doing some cool stuff in the ocean, you know, which I wish we saw the rest of that episode, but you know, we're really with Rick's nemesis in that episode. But I think that's about who Summer is. She's a regular old teenager. She's a feminist. She's outspoken. She is not maybe the coolest kid in school, probably too smart for her age, and has a really, really not great at a love life, or she's just kind of non-committal, I guess. She takes after Rick in that point of view.
Yeah. Well, you gave us more than a breakdown. That was the whole character arc right there.
Sorry. Did you want just a breakdown? I'm sorry. I thought, you know, let's tease Summer for everyone. Like, if you didn't like her in the beginning, she gets more interesting. You just gotta keep going. Get to the end.
No, that's fantastic. As a former English major, I love that.
Thanks. So. Finishing graduate school over here, just like couldn't give you like that, just like the one liner. Yep. Yeah, she's like a typical teenager. Next question.
Yeah, but you're absolutely right. You do see Summer grow up a lot. And grow, I guess, closer to Rick in certain ways.
I think so. I've been pushing for that in general. I just want her to have more Rick-centric personality traits. I think it's fun. I think it's fun to see a female character who can also be sometimes unlikable, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. It makes her more believable. It makes her more human. Might explain the show's popularity. There are a lot of memorable moments for all of these characters. Do you think you have a favorite Summer moment that you'd like to share?
Is it called The Ricks Must Be Crazy? No, it's the one where it's like Keep Summer Safe, where she's in the, I think that's like probably the most memorable Summer moment, one of, right? But that one particularly, I think really, I remember going into that recording session, I talk about it often, but going into that recording session and reading and being like, this is so dark, you guys, and amazing. Yeah. Like that we use psychological warfare, and that like, Summer's character, you know, is upset because the ship ends up melting a baby, you know, or as a man's dead child. It's like, it's so, it's amazing. I think it was one of the times, you know, it was in one of the earlier seasons where I realized how really truly wonderful animation was, because there were no limits to the amount of ways you could keep that storyline going. Like the whole plot of that B storyline is keep Summer safe, right? Yeah. And it becomes the motto of her story. And nothing that happens to Summer with that ship, it feels safe at all. Like, there's, except she's in there. And, but like, you're never safe if you're watching all of the turmoil go down in front of you. Like, Summer's like, never, never fine after that. I think maybe that's where Summer's arc really turned for her. You know, she was like, well, that's it. Like, this is the family. Like, now I'm Rick. Now I've seen all that I need to see. And, but I think that's one of my favorite moments. And, you know, I also love when she puts on snake jazz in that last in season four. It's one of my favorite, snake jazz is one of my favorite things ever. I personally love that episode so much. Also the end of the episode where we have, you know, DMX, the song that DMX, and then they, like, pump iron and then they, like, go beat up people. It's like amazing. There's like some beautiful, beautiful moments that just, you know, there's not even that much dialogue in some of those parts, that they just mean a lot, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah. I remember going in.
Moments. Yeah.
Yeah. Those are some of my favorite moments for sure.
Thank you so much for sharing, Spencer. I really appreciate it. I know where I'm getting a little close on time here.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. Any more questions? Sorry. I told you.
No, that's fine. I've got
full disclosure.
This is fantastic. I've got one more question for you. Okay. It's a little more broad. So if you need to think for a second,
okay,
please go ahead. So Rick and Morty has become one of the most popular animated series on television. Why do you think this show resonates so strongly with people, especially young adults?
I would say there's a lot of tropes that get reversed in the show. There's a lot of familiar things, right? We have like a dysfunctional family. We have a grandfather, son, sort of like a Doc and Marty Back to the Future thing. So we sort of recognize that. And then we have, you know, an absent father who comes back into Beth's life.
Yeah.
We have a dysfunctional husband and wife who like separate, get back together. There's a lot of like, and then on top of that, you add sci-fi and other worlds and dimensions and anything's possible, right?
Yeah.
On top of it. And I think that gives the audience a catharsis. I think it's also very, you know, while it's specific, it's also universal. Those are things I think that make the story so much more accessible. And it looks cool. Like, it's well animated. I mean, they do some crazy stuff. Like the animators, the background artists, like for the background animation, like they have built worlds beyond which are normal for 22 minute episodes, or however long they are now, 30 minutes or so, right? And hold on, I lost my earpiece. It's fine. Hey, Zoom. Yeah, so good. You guys, I'm so profesh. I think that those things all together ultimately have created something that is, you know, irreverent and contemporary and of the moment, you know. And I can go back at older episodes and they still resonate now. Like, I think there's that episode with the parasites, right, where like they have to lock down the whole house, and there's all these like, there's a parasitic worm, and now everybody like thinks that there's like new characters and that they all have good memories of them, right? That like,
I remember that.
That then they know that they're not real. If they remember there's like a terrible thing that they did, then you're like, oh yeah, like that, to me, that's very funny. Like in life, you know, you're not necessarily remembering people just because of the happy moments they give you, because that's unrealistic. Life is full of and fraught with potentially unhappy moments in between really good ones. You know, and then just the lockdown, right? Like we just experienced the lockdown. I was like, there's so many things in Rick and Morty that I was like, they've predicted so many things, you guys. I think they say the same thing for The Simpsons, actually. I think The Simpsons said that like Donald Trump was gonna be president at some point and he ended up being president. But that's what I've heard in the rhetoric of some kind, but in the walla of animation.
I think you've summed it up perfectly. There's a lot to be said for this. It's intelligent. It's contemporary, like you said. Yeah. And for me, at least, what I find really striking or even moving about this show is how it just moves so deftly between hilarious comedy and really somber, almost heartrending drama. I mean, there's some very real moments of characterization there, right? That are Agreed. Kind of sad. Yeah.
Yeah, I know that they get a lot of ability to traverse between those two sides, which I think they hired a really great group of actors as well to portray that too. You know, great writers. I mean, you never know when you do a show how it's going to turn out a lot of the time, and it just takes like a certain amount of magic to make it all work. The right actors, the right directors, the right storytellers, the right everything. And you know, I think we got really lucky with Rick and Morty, and so grateful that we can bring as much entertainment as we can to the world, you know.
Yeah, well said. Thank you so much, Spencer.
Thank you.
Well, for everybody tuning in, if you'd like to watch Rick and Morty, if you don't already know, it's going to make its season 5 debut this Sunday, June 20th at 11 p.m. Eastern Time on Adult Swim. If you're listening to this recording after the premiere, don't despair. There will be new episodes every Sunday. Spencer, once again, can't thank you enough for coming here today.
Oh, of course. Yeah, thank you.
Anything else you'd like to say before we wrap up?
Well, thank you for a lovely interview. You're very eloquent and lovely to speak to, so appreciate that. Thank you for being a fan. It's always so nice to talk to people who really love the show, because it means a lot to me. I love doing it, so it's for the fans.
Absolutely. Yeah. Thanks, Spencer. All the best to you in the future.
Yeah, thank you. You too. Talk to you soon. Maybe.